reading from Isaiah, chapter 9, verses 2 to 7. It can be found on page 555 of the Pew Bibles. People who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as people exult with dividing thunder. For the yoke of their burden, and the bar across the shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken, as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the tramping warriors, and all the garments rolled in blood, shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of the hosts will do this. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from the book of Titus, chapter 2, verses 11 through 14. This can be found on page 969 in your Bible. For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all, training us to renounce impiety and worldly passions, and in the that are self-controlled, upright, and godly, while we wait for the blessed hope and the manifestation of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus the Christ. He is who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify for himself a people of his own who are zealous for good deeds. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
chapter 2, verses 1 through 14. It may be found on page 832 in your pew Bible. Please stand for the reading of the gospel. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Cyrenius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged, and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child, and she gave birth to her firstborn son, and wrapped him in bands of cloth, and laid him in a manger, for there was no room for them in the inn. In that region, there were shepherds lying in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angels a multitude of the heavenly host, praising and saying, "Glory to God in the heaven and on earth, peace among those whom he favors." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
copy my kids. And, I wrote something about the light has come, Merry Christmas. And one of my kids says, what are you saying, Dad? You're the light of the world? No, that wasn't coming from that. Anyway, so I'll be not texting any pictures. If you were with us this Advent, you know that I've been doing a series on the Messiah, and we come to the triumphant end of the Advent season, Christmas, and what would be more fitting than to talk about the Hallelujah Chorus? The Hallelujah Chorus, the founder of Methodism, was a contemporary of George Frederick Handel, who wrote the Hallelujah Chorus, and so Wesley could go and hear performed live in London, I would assume, and came back from that performance early on, maybe wasn't the first, but one of the early performances of the Hallelujah Chorus. He came back and he wrote in his diary, it was fine, but I don't think it's going to last. Well, 275 years later, here we are, the most performed out piece of classical music in Western music history. Which reminds me, have you ever performed it? Some of you have, I know. I have. I've sung it, and we'll sing it with the choir in a few minutes. Sung it. Maybe you've sung it with us on Easter, usually. I play the trombone. I've played the violin on it. You know what scares me about it? Probably if you performed it, you know. A grand pause. Remember that part, the last line? Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I can't tell you how many times I've hod, tooted, or sawed in that grand pause, right? I know. I think I'm going to phone it in and let Jeff carry the man's But, so, the Hallelujah Chorus, it is the victory song of the cosmic Christmas story, the battle between good and evil, and it answers the age-old question, who runs the world? You've been asking that since the beginning of time. And in our secular day, many people will say, well, it's the strong who run the world, right? So we exercise, we lift weights, we build bigger bombs. Kim Jong-un is willing to starve his people in North Korea so that a nuclear warhead can hit you and I. Strong one run the world, he believes. And yet, Handel himself had an experience about 5 years before he wrote the Messiah. And that is, in 1737, he had a stroke. He could no longer do what he had been doing, and that was conducting and performing. I don't know what instrument he played, but performing. And he could no longer do that after the stroke. And so he, in his weakness, he wondered if he was going to be worth anything anymore. And then when you live into your weakness and vulnerability, what happens? But a new strength blossoms, and he started composing. When he was composing the Hallelujah Chorus, his assistant came into his little office and saw him sitting at the desk writing, and there were tears streaming down his eyes. And the assistant asked, why? And Handel said, I think I've seen the heavens open, and I think I've seen the face of God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. So Handel himself knew that the strong don't run the world. So then, in our day, if it's not the strong who run the world, maybe the rich run the world, right? Isn't this why our kids and grandkids and nieces and nephews start in early December talking about how last year so many of their friends got so many more presents than they did and so much nicer present than they did? And if Grandma makes the mistake of getting them flannel PJs, when they open up, they toss it to the sun. But you and I know that Christmas is not about the material things, so we'll make the kid walk over to Grandma and say reluctantly, thank you for the PJs. Because the rich don't run the world either. So who runs the world, according to the cosmic Christmas story that Hallelujah Chorus celebrates. Well, the cosmic Christmas story says that the control room of the universe is a manger in a store. And that the way that the Hallelujah Chorus sings it, and I won't get it exactly right here, but the kingdoms of this world is become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever. In other words, that babe is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. You see, the world, Christmas says, and the Hallelujah Chorus affirms, is under new magic. So it's not the strong who run the world. It's a weak, vulnerable baby, God entering into space and time in Jesus. And you know, at our best we see it. You maybe remember this image from the news last year. That's Emmanuel AME Zion Church in Charleston, South Carolina. You remember, right? The Dylan Roof came in and massacred 9 African American people at a Wednesday night Bible study, right? And but do you know the backstory to Mother Emmanuel, as the African American community calls its church? Do you know, or do you remember that in the Civil War, not once but twice, he was burned to the ground? Do you remember that after the Civil War, when the Negro preacher, which would be saying it kindly, is the way they would express it back then, got a little uppity, that the KKK made sure that they made an example of not one but 2 of their black preachers and hung them in effigy in the front of the church so the whole town could see what the strong can do to the weak. But do you remember the end of the story with Dylan Roof? How many of those members who've been beaten and bloodied throughout their history as a church, they showed up at the arraignment of Dylan Roof and they said in effect, "You took life. But if you receive Jesus, you'll have life." Because Mother Emmanuel, it's not the strong who run the world. As a matter of fact, Jesus himself said, "Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth." So the strong don't run the world. Neither do the rich. I would say that the cosmic Christmas story, affirmed by the Hallelujah Chorus, says that the generous run the world. That's why this poor peasant baby Jesus, born to parents who had to live from hand to mouth, it could be said of him that he is King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and he shall reign. And that's what St. Paul said. In his commentary on Christmas, he said in Corinthians, "He who was rich became poor for us, that through his poverty we might become rich." And that's why so many of you came tonight prepared to be generous, because you heard, for the first time in 193 Christmases of this church history, that the Christmas offerings aren't going to go to pay heat and light, but it's going to go out, and it's going to rebuild St. Thomas. If you've been here in December, you've heard Grace McGeon talk about how she had to flee on the last cruise ship on St. Thomas, and this was her friend who survived the hurricanes barely, and that's all that has left of his house in so many places in St. Thomas and in the islands there. And we've developed a relationship with St. Thomas Reformed Church, and everything that you give tonight, unless you designate it for something else, will be going to rebuild St. Thomas, because the Christmas story says that God rebuilds the world because it's under new magic. Strong don't run the world. The rich don't run the world. Who runs the world? Christ runs. The one of love and joy and peace and justice runs the world. And that's why the last word of that great victory song that the choir will sing in just a moment, and I'll walk out at the last, or phone in the last line. Ends with Hallelujah. Or whatever the soprano sing, I always sing in case you're kind of fun. Yeah, I can't do that either. But the last word of Christmas is Hollywood. You've been around here for a while. This is my 19th Christmas with you. I've told a couple times the story of my pastor grandfather's last words as my grandmother related them to me. Because he died before I was born in 1951 of colon cancer. And the way I heard the story was that it was the Friday after Thanksgiving, 2 o'clock in the morning, and the knock came on